Okay, so when we were planning this conference, I just come to our planning committee meeting and Dr. Mayer looks at me and was like, Shanila, what do you think about talking about weird causes of strokes? So I'm like, smile, and I'm like, sure. And inside, I'm like, what the heck am I gonna talk about? And so my current stroke fellow helped me out and tagged me on a Facebook page, Women Neurology. And all of a sudden, I get a lot of different ideas of different causes of stroke. They're just coming left and right. And as you can see, they're endless. There's so many, and this can take about 2 days to go through different causes. So two of the most interesting causes that came up on that Facebook chat was fat emboli from liposuction. And a patient always having a stroke every time IV fluids were being run into them because the PICC line was put into the carotid artery. However, here we have different MRIs. These are just different strokes that we've seen here at Henry Ford. Some of them look like your typical embolic appearing strokes, small vessel disease. And then some are quite weird, different ages, different locations, some little random little dots. So we have to investigate them thoroughly. So we had to pick three things that we learned. So I divided it into three topics: vasculitis, vasculopathy, or actual physical changes of the blood vessels, coagulopathies, or things that cause the blood clots to form, and then our systemic diseases or inherited disorders. Dissection. So my residents are going to be like, Dr. Malik, this is not uncommon. We see it all the time. However, it is uncommon in the general population and in the community hospitals. It's seen in middle age, young folks, less than 40 years old. Men get in about fourth decade, women in about the fifth decade. The causes of dissection are very strange. So you can have trauma. It doesn't have to be a blunt trauma. It can be a simple thing like shoveling snow or going to the salon, or someone falling asleep on the airplane and wake up and they had a dissection. You have pre-existing arterial disease or fibromuscular dysplasia, recent viral illnesses, and then structural abnormalities such as styloid process elongation, or it's called the Eagle syndrome. So here we had a 32-year-old gentleman come to our stroke unit who is the vice president of a major company in the Metro Detroit area, completely healthy, very athletic, no medical problems ever, woke up and had a left MCA stroke. And we see that he has a dissection of the left ICA. And he's been going back and forth for business to Europe and had multiple airplane rides, and all we could speculate was the cause of his stroke being falling asleep and somehow kinking the carotid and causing the dissection. So carotid dissections, they present with one-third of them have Horner syndrome, about 10% have cranial nerve palsies, and then you can have migraine-like symptoms. Vertebral dissections majority have a headache, mainly in the occipital region, and they also have neck pain. And the most common clinical feature is Wallenberg syndrome. So what's the treatment? There's always been the debate. Aspirin, Coumadin, what do we do? So you can use Coumadin or antiplatelet therapy in extracranial dissections, but a few years ago, the CADIS study came out, and basically they showed no difference between the two of them. However, you would not do anticoagulation intracranially because of the higher risk of subarachnoid hemorrhage, and that's due to the fact there's only two layers of blood vessels intracranially. The prognosis of dissections is very good. About 3/4 have complete or excellent recovery, and the recurrence within the first month is less than 2%. So in Africa, we have a lot of zebras. In North America, we rarely ever see them. Just like Moyamoya disease is very common and is more common in Asia and is becoming more recognizable in North America. So what exactly is Moyamoya disease? You can have ischemic or hemorrhagic strokes. It's an arteriopathy in children and young adults that result in progressive narrowing of the distal ICA, MCA, and ACA arteries. You develop collateral, lenticular striate collaterals, and so on an angiogram, you'll see a group of blood vessels that look like a puff of smoke, and hence Moyamoya. So common associations with Moyamoya syndrome, Down syndrome, sickle cell disease, and autoimmune disorders like Graves, lupus, or Sjogren's. So this was a 26-year-old female that came when I was a resident. She came encephalopathic, not knowing anything, what's going on. Couldn't really, non-focal exam, but she had multiple strokes in multiple territories, different ages. And as you can see on the MRA, the circle of Willis basically does not exist. So what's the treatment? You can start with antiplatelet therapies and then treat the underlying disorder if there's any present, such as Graves' disease. If you have recurrent strokes, you want to do a CT perfusion scan with Dymox. And if it shows poor perfusion, then the patient should undergo revascularization. So the ECIC bypass, or EDAS or EDAMS, are the two or three procedures that neurosurgeons do. So we live in Detroit. So 5 million people in the world, in the United States, use cocaine. It's very common in Detroit. They cause ischemic stroke or ICHs, and it's due to vasospasm, hypertension, and abnormal platelet aggregation. And heroin is also a cause of stroke because of the injections can cause infectious endocarditis and septal emboli. So amphetamines is another cause. So we have to always look at the drugs people are on. They also cause ICH, subarachnoid hemorrhage, or ischemic stroke. And you get vasculitic-like changes. So here we had a 30-year-old kid, in my mind kid, came in and had this hemorrhage. And the residents look at me and say, Dr. Malik, it's because of hypertension. Well, this is not in a typical region for hypertension. Plus, the patient's not hypertensive. He has no history of hypertension. His blood vessels were normal on the angiogram. There was no evidence of aneurysm, AVM, nothing. In further evaluation and questioning of the patient, he finally admits that he takes 5 to 10 energy drinks a day. And that has become a very common cause of stroke in young folks. So it's always important to ask people what extra things they're doing. And energy drinks cause strokes because of vasoconstriction, just like cocaine. And there's actually over 100 lawsuits currently for the Monster company because of strokes related to their product. Other types of drugs that can cause vasoconstriction, sumatriptan, SSRIs. And in my review for this talk, I found that hypercalcemia can cause vasoconstriction. Don't ask me, I just put it down. So there's something called spontaneous reversible vasoconstriction, or called Fleming syndrome. So the MRI on the bottom is a young lady who just gave birth to twin girls. And 3 weeks later, she started having numbness and headaches. She went to her local hospital. They found on FLIR imaging that she had all these strokes in the posterior circulation. Her MRA at that time didn't look like anything majorly abnormal, except she was found to have a few little aneurysms. She was transferred to our institution, and she became having more neurological symptoms, and she found to have an acute stroke about 3 days later. And if you look at her repeat MRA, you can see that both her MCAs are very narrowed and basically non-existent. She was in active vasospasm. She underwent a cerebral angiogram, and we gave local nimodipine with some minimal relief of that vasospasm. So these patients actually have sudden headaches. They can have seizures, neurological deficits. You do a lumbar puncture, it's normal. The neuro deficits can start a few days after the headaches. It's very difficult to diagnose, just like it's difficult to find the lions in the jungle when they're looking for their prey that you can see up there. So you need to rule out subarachnoid hemorrhage and primary vasculitis. And the treatments of called Fleming syndrome is steroids or calcium channel blockers. So we're going to switch gears. I'm going to very briefly talk about disorders of coagulation. You have to search for these. Just like you have to look twice to see the crocodile in this water, you have to search hard for these abnormalities and do a lot of blood work. So antiphospholipid antibody syndrome is one of the common syndromes we see here. Protein CNS deficiency, antithrombin deficiency, polycythemia, essential thrombocythemia, sickle cell disease, and some genetic factors like factor V Leiden and MTHFR reductase. Those typically present with venous clots more than arterial clots. So we had a young 25-year-old who has lupus, who is on dialysis, who came in with this hemorrhage. She was on anticoagulation because of having DVTs. And we stopped the anticoagulation, and we just had a whole discussion about anticoagulation. But 2 months later, despite not being on anticoagulation, she came back with another hemorrhage. So she actually has antiphospholipid antibody syndrome. She needs to have long-term anticoagulation. So I just briefly just put the different blood works that you should order on patients when you're looking up hypercoagulable state in young folks with no other explained cause of stroke. So we'll switch gears to systemic diseases. So primary systemic angiitis. So they can be split into three, four categories: necrotizing, giant cell, and granulomatous. I'm not going to go through all of that. You have it on your flash drive. So there's a lot of autoimmune diseases and inherited diseases, just like there's a lot of wildebeest in Africa. So I'm not going to talk about all of them, but I'm presenting two cases that we saw here on our service. There's a 62-year-old female. She just came to our emergency room just with swelling of the leg, a common problem that ED staff always see. They did a routine CBC, and the diligent ED resident noted that there was elevated WBC count, low platelets counts, and a lot of eosinophils in the blood. She also had this strange rash on her. So they had dermatology do a skin biopsy, and she had eosinophils on the specimen. She was being treated with prednisone, thinking she has because of some autoimmune issue. 4 months later, we found that she had slurred speech and generalized weakness. She comes back and she's got this crazy MRI, dots everywhere. Like, what the heck is going on? It's some vasculitic process. The MRA doesn't show very good healthy blood vessels. So this is hyperviscosity secondary hypereosinophilia syndrome. I never heard of it until I saw this patient. So we can learn every day from the patients that we see. These patients have to be treated with hydroxyurea. Unfortunately, she did pass because they couldn't get her autoimmune under control, and she had multiple other comorbidities. So I had to put this case in because the chapter in the book was written by someone from Henry Ford Hospital. So this is a 50-year-old male. He presented with diplopia. And he was found to have this pontine stroke. So my residents would probably say, Dr. Malik, small vessel disease, send them home, put them on aspirin, right? So this is actually Fabry's disease. So it's a rare X-linked disorder, accumulation of glycolipoproteins, initially can have episodic pain crises, and they start having strokes in their fourth to fifth decade of life. And typically they will have small vessel disease strokes. And they normally involve the vertebral basilar system. So the treatment is very difficult. We do treat them still with the underlying antiplatelet therapy. However, it is not linked to just smoking and blood pressure, but linked to their underlying autoimmune disease. So I just wanted to put on a few disorders associated with problems of vision. So there's Eales retinopathy, acute posterior multifocal placoid pigment epitheliopathy. Never heard of it, I put it on there. Marfan syndrome, Susak's, and Hearns. So, and then there's things that have skin disorders like Behçet's, Sweet syndrome. There's only about 4 or 5 cases published on Sweet syndrome. Sneddon syndrome. So basically I put these on saying that we have to look at the patient at whole. We have to look at them like everything, on their skin, get a good history. What else are they taking in order to diagnose why they're actually having strokes? So the last case is a 27-year-old, 14-week pregnant woman who came in with acute aphasia. She had a stroke at the age of 19 and 20 after giving birth. She had her hypocrag workup done and everything came back negative, even genetic testing. TEE was normal, but she came in with this left MCA stroke and a clot in the left MCA artery. 1 month later, she came in with worsening right side weakness. We admitted her, we got an MRI, and she has a stroke on the other side and a clot on the other side. This time, the blood work showed everything negative except beta 2 glycoprotein, came back a little bit elevated. She was then diagnosed with antiphospholipid antibody syndrome and is on lifelong anticoagulation. So bottom line, we have to keep searching for the cause of stroke because we never know what we may miss. We may even find something as rare as the rhino in the Serengeti National Park.